there, fellow foot lovers. I'm Pruitt, and this is Jim Davis. It's time to kick off the shoes for a little bit of the Bat-tootsie. Let's suit it up and break out the gimp. We're talking Pulp Fiction on WebD.
The pulps. You know, the cheap genre fiction, weird tales, amazing stories.
Yeah, Tarantino pulps. Makes some amazing stories because it's Pulp Fiction on WebDM. Okay, Jim. Pulp. What is this thing? People have asked us before. Yeah, we mentioned, like, hey, you know, we're talking about Pulp Fiction. Like, oh, the movie. Yeah, no.
Way to make me feel old, guys.
Let's run through this immense influence on D&D.
When we talk about pulp, we are not talking about orange juice or anything like that. We are talking about a style of cheap genre fiction that was popular from, like, the early 1900s up through the 50s or so, 1950s. It's called pulp because it's made with cheap paper. Like, wood pulp paper.
Tell it's the texture and the smell
of it. Yeah, it's a mode of production, mode of printing that uses cheap materials, cheap process, and cheap labor to produce cheap fiction, entertainment. It is the foundation of not every, but a significant number of forms of entertainment today, like superhero comics, comic books in general, action movies. All of them have antecedents in Pulp Fiction, which is itself has antecedents in Penny Dreadfuls, things like that. These works of literature, which are not high art, this is not, you're not like elevating your intellect, but they're damn fun.
Yeah, you're not peeling back your third eye or...
You're reading a lot of like Clark Ashton Smith, maybe.
Wow, yeah.
But I enjoy them because they're cheap entertainment. Because they're kind of trashy, because they're kind of exploitative and the media sense, and they're titillating, you know, and a lot of them, not necessarily the ones that inspired D&D, but are also like racy and risque.
Like that extra button unbuttoned on the dress.
Right, or like hard-boiled crime fiction, like, you know, what would inspire Tarantino, you know, that's the
exactly
where that comes from.
So, that's where he got the name.
Yeah. You probably are familiar with the big two, Lovecraft and Howard.
Oh, yeah.
And they certainly appear on the list of D&D's influences in Appendix N of the first edition DMG. I think it's worth talking about some of the lesser known authors that appear on that list that are also Pulp Fiction authors, and just like why in 2020 is worth reading some literature that's, you know, 100 years old or more for your D&D games.
Yeah.
And it's not there's a reason we keep referencing them.
Yeah, and it's not on your semester syllabus reading list.
Probably not.
Okay, so we kind of know what it is now.
Yeah.
So we never have to answer that question again in the comments.
And certainly, ever again.
If a lot of these aren't on the reading list for the DMG...
Yeah.
Some of them are. But
some of them are, but most of them are, yeah.
But what did it really mean for D&D, though? Not all of them had fantastical elements.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. And they certainly have varying degrees of them. You know, Earth and a Jack Vance Staunton novel is very different than some of, say, Fritz Lieber's stuff.
Yeah.
You know, some of it's outright science fiction. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not necessarily fantasy at all. There's some qualities to this kind of literature. And the genre of fantasy that it's most steeped in is, of course, sword and sorcery. Mm-hmm. Which is about the sort of personal struggles of the protagonists. It's sort of amoral, and I know that a lot of people don't like murder hobos in D&D. They don't like amoral kind of player characters, but I see the default as being, yeah, you're just immoral. You're neither good nor bad. You are self-interested. As, like, maximizing the player agency. And then if they choose to become heroic, if they choose to be do-gooders, then that's okay. If they choose the other path, that's okay. And so a lot of these stories are like that. Sometimes you're rooting for them because they're the good guy and they're doing something heroic and noble. And sometimes you root for them because they're the protagonist and they're the hero of an action story.
And they're surviving.
And they're surviving. And it's very personal. And to me, D&D works best when it is about the personal. D&D is like, if you look at it in sort of like an archetypal sense, it's a coming of age story. You know, it's the quest, the transformation of a person from, you know, humble beginnings to greatness.
Yeah.
That's the kind of the meta narrative of it. And a lot of these pulp stories and the sword and sorcery fiction kind of swim in the same waters. Mm-hmm. And they also feature very shallow protagonists that have broad archetypal appeal. So, you know, when I think of like John Carter of Mars, I'm not thinking of a protagonist that's like super in depth and I'm going to like get inside the psyche of this character. And that's very much how these stories are written. Mm-hmm. They're written for the reader, in a lot of cases, young white men, to like identify with. And when you take that principle and you say, like, okay, number one, let's apply this to everybody equally, because they're going to make their own characters. They're going to make their own protagonist for a story that they're going to play out and then tell to themselves and their friends later. Then D&D becomes a game less about, like, inhabiting a persona, another person, and more creating an avatar for yourself that you're excited to inhabit as you personally explore a fantasy world someone else makes. And, like, the best pulp stories, the best sword and sorcery fiction go beyond, like, the personal and kind of just create an environment where you're caught up in the adventure itself and you're caught up in the action yourself, and it's like you're there. And the fact that it's got shallow personalities and deals in archetypes and cliches is sometimes problematic, and sometimes for very good reasons can turn people off of it, but it also has this advantage of being a place for you to inhabit and a way for you to experience this in a way that's just really thrilling.
It's one of those things where a lot of times you know exactly who the villains are. This isn't like a big twist kind of thing. He's twirling his mustache and pointing his death ray, you know, at the
lead. Sacrificial dagger poised
over the lady,
the captive.
That you're supposed to save. It does give you kind of that stark choice of do you be a hero?
Yeah.
Or do you
yeah.
survive? It's playtime. It's what you were doing in your backyard anyway.
When you think about it in terms of, like, how they were sold and how they're marketed, you know, for people who are working their bones off in the early years of the, you know, industrialization of the 20th century, it's escapism. It's a fantasy. A lot of times they feature exotic locales. There's action and adventure. Now, sometimes those exotic locales are in the world, on Earth. And they come with all the problematic tropes and themes and everything that you can imagine that fiction written in the teens and 20s a century ago would have. But a lot of times the sword and planet genre, the planetary romance, the further you get into science fantasy, the more they just make up whole worlds.
Yeah.
And they leave Earth behind and sort of are creating these exotic locations. And that's, again, that's what a dungeon master's doing, right? There's a lot of overlap.
In those stories, a lot of times, by putting it out there, you can still kind of take on some of the social issues.
Certainly, you change things up.
But you change it enough
that
it's not necessarily like appropriation or doing it a disservice. It's just what good fantasy and science fiction should do.
Yeah.
Which is kind of just give you a big stark lens to look through.
Yeah.
And
something,
go have some
something
fun.
For yourself. Yeah.
Right?
Exactly. Have fun in creating something for yourself that fits your needs and the needs of your group. This isn't a question of, like, should you read these things that are in, say, Appendix N of the DMG, or even like the new inspirational lead reading list there in 5th edition. There's one in the DMG and the Player's Handbook. It's not like, you know, you can't run a game of D&D without, you know, committing this literature to heart. It's an option. And because this is the fiction that the creators of the game were steeping themselves in when they were making it, and because that has continued in some form and some thread to the current edition, it's worthwhile to go, like, all right, just exactly what is an encounter with, you know, fairies supposed to look like? Well, maybe you go to Three Hearts and Three Lions and read Paul Anderson, and you see how Paul Anderson presents the world of fairy and the elves that live there, and how, you know, they try to manipulate the hero. Or you've heard about Vancey and magic. What even is this? And why would you choose to do that this way? And then you go read Tales from the Dying Earth and about how Turgeon is, you know, a powerful magic user because he can fit 5 spells in his head. And that takes effort. It takes time. He's got to sit down with a book and force those otherworldly demons bound in the ink on page to inhabit his brain.
Yeah.
And then it's going to go off and have an adventure. A lot of things in D&D that look stupid or silly or weird, these are evocative fiction that's had to be translated into game elements.
Yeah.
So reading the fiction will help get an idea. You know, I was all in on Vancey and magic after reading Tales of Dying Earth.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh my God, this is awesome.
Well, you just mentioned a few authors. Who should DMs and players look for that maybe aren't, like, you know, the ones that are, obviously.
Yeah,
but
sure.
Who are some
of
the other ones that maybe they can find, or know?
You know, like I said, mentioned earlier, you're probably familiar with the two big names in this genre, and that's H.P. Lovecraft and R.E. Howard. And while Lovecraft and Howard, who are writing sort of Cthulhu mythos and Conan stories, respectively, although sometimes they cross over, are fun, they're also not the end of the line. And there are, to me, 4 of the lesser known or lesser recognized now authors that were on Appendix N, and including one that is shamefully shamefully not on Appendix N or in the revised one that Gygax released later in the 80s, and that's Clark Ashton Smith. So start with Clark Ashton Smith, Jack Vance, Fritz Lieber, and Paul Anderson. And to me, these four authors, when you read their stuff, when you go live in their worlds, they are effortlessly D&D worlds. Like, you do not really have to do anything. Like, literally, Clark Ashton Smith, one of the first stories of his I read, I think it's like Seven Geshes, is like, it's a barbarian king of some kind who's traveling up this mountain going to hunt these sort of Neanderthal type man apes or something, and runs across a wizard at the top of this mountain who's just annoyed. That the wizard's just annoyed they've been interrupted, and cast this like powerful suggestion, this Gesh spell on this barbarian king. And it's like, go into these caves past where the ape men live, the Vormis, and like talk to this demigod that's down there. You know, go ask him if he needs anything. Buzz off. You know, the use of powerful enchantments just makes somebody go away. Yeah. And then it's like, it's the story of this noble warrior and king descending further and further into the earth, and each one of these monstrosities that he encounters, who's about to tell me why I shouldn't eat you, tell me why I shouldn't destroy you, and he's like, tries to find a way to get out of it, and it's like, well, I made myself useful to this guy, maybe you can find use with me. And they just keep sending him further and further along, and it's like almost like back in time the further deep he goes, because it's like, oh, I ran across the serpent folk of Yig that haven't inhabited the world in over 4,000 millennia,
yeah,
or something like that. You know, there's Sathuga who's down here, and yeah, I managed to not get eaten by the demon toad of hell, you know, until eventually it's like, that's it. You know, it doesn't get out, if I recall. It just ends. And there's so many just fun stories from Clark Ashton Smith, and he's just the facility of language and the way he presents worlds, whether it's Zothik, which is this supercontinent, kind of like a Pangaea or something like that from earlier epochs, but it's in the future, right? Mm-hmm. It's kind of like a Numenera setup. And
yeah, yeah.
It's a far-flung kind of like, the world is dying, you know, sort of adventure fiction. There's Hyperborea, which is the ones I'm most familiar with. And it's like this sort of decadent land of adventure. You know, you've got like twisting sort of venal merchants and, you know, barbaric warlords and kings and wicked sorcerers. And it's a lot like Conan, but it's also like really not like Conan. It's just much weirder and more evocative. And to me, it's like, if you're familiar with Earl Otis, the early D&D artist, like, I see, to me, him and Clark Ashton Smith are very much in the same vein, whereas Howard's over here and his armor is historically accurate, and they look like, you know, ancient warlords and people from actual history. Clark Ashton Smith is over here like, nah, these people are bonkers. Earl, you know, they got the Earl Otis weird helmets and the crazy costumes, and they look like extras from a pre-Star Wars sci-fi movie, mm-hmm, or something like that, like Flash Gordon or something. Just bizarre, and I love it. Clark Ashton Smith would be number one for just weird fiction. You know, mm-hmm, this is the guy who Lovecraft loved and inspired, you know, and just couldn't stop raving about, and others have, you know, cited as influences. He wrote like epic poetry. Like, who writes epic poetry outside of 8th century Danes? You're like, who does that anymore?
I don't know, Jim.
And who writes it about liches? You know, who writes it about undead sorcerers that are trying to, you know, anyway. Clark Ashton Smith, very cool. And not on the list. I think it's a shame. I don't know. I guess Gygax didn't like him or something. The next one I would say, and this is one you've done some reading on, would be Jack Vance.
Oh, yeah.
Jack Vance's influence on RPGs is considerable. Mm-hmm. When you consider the fact that the premier magic, you know, the premier RPG with its magic system bears his name. I also think that The Thief is incredibly influenced by Cudgel the Clever, Kugel or Kugel. I don't know. Really,
I always say Cudgel.
I say Cudgel as well.
I mean,
I like
the way it's spelled, right?
Is there? Yeah, I don't know. Anyway,
whatever.
There are.
But he's an asshole. He's still kind of cheer for him sometimes.
Yeah, it's a picaresque, right? A picaresque type of story. You're not supposed to learn anything. You're not supposed to be a better person at the end of it. There's no character growth or development. It's just a snippet of life from this kind of rapscallion ne'er-do-well type character. Mm-hmm. You just get to watch them trick people for a while. They don't learn anything.
Yeah.
They don't, you know, the next story is completely unconnected from the previous one. It's just little slices of life.
Yeah.
And adventure. And man, when you're reading it, you're like, yeah, that's a PC. Like,
he's a total.
So many PCs acting.
He's a murder hobo PC, duping people out of their pearls
just
on the beach.
Terrible to each other. Just absolutely terrible.
Yeah, exactly.
Is there one with a bottle of wine?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Jack Vance, the ones I'm most familiar with are the Tales from the Dying Earth series, or just Dying Earth. And I think there's four novellas or collections of short stories from them. Don't remember all their names, but Eyes of the Overworld would be one of the big ones. And it's the people in this world are self-consciously, like, they're aware that their world is dying. And, it could be tomorrow.
It's the end. Yeah.
Right. The sun could go out tomorrow. And yet they are committed to just living these decadent, hedonistic lifestyles where everybody's sort of self-interested. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like the quintessential, you know, dark kind of world, but if it wasn't so goofy and so silly and so madcap at times, it would be super dark. But it's the weirdness that keeps it from, you know, it's like mm-hmm. the monsters that will just sort of talk and debate and chat with their victims, or the fact that like everyone before they fight has to give these grand monologues and the flowery language that's the big thing for me with both Vance and Smith is mm-hmm. the use of language to hint at a greater world that never comes.
Yeah, it's referencing to this great thing that you never really see.
You never really see.
It's just the person who is there saying it is the herald of it.
Yeah,
and so
yeah.
It speaks to a greater thing, and you know, it's in an idea generator. It's an imagination place, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. And contrast it with someone like, say, Tolkien, where it's like there's a reference to something, and you're pretty certain you could go read about it in another book.
Or you could read many, many pages about it.
Right. If there's a reference to something in Vance, probably not. That's probably the only time it's mentioned.
Yeah.
It never gets developed.
Well, you might hear it referenced by somebody else.
Somewhere,
it's just a reference.
Yeah.
And it's all that is just like, well, I guess that is probably real since two different characters referenced it.
Yeah, and it's proof positive if you look at the Dying Earth role-playing game from Pellegrine Press, where the world section of what the world is like is very scant. You're really supposed to kind of make it up yourself, mm-hmm. and there's much more effort given to creating your magic user with all their different panache and styles mm-hmm. of dress and things like that. You know, mm-hmm. this is a world of wizards who are standing on the shoulders of giants and dealing with things they don't understand kind of situation.
Oh, yes. Great technologies left over from ages past.
It's unclear what is magic, what isn't technology. Mm-hmm. But like the very first story of it, you're talking about a wizard who's trying to grow people in vats.
Yep.
And has to go on an adventure to secure the favor of another wizard who's going to help him out with his problem
mm-hmm.
that of not being able to grow a person.
But yeah, he's got a, because yeah, that's the one where the dude suits up.
Yeah.
And he puts on his magic items.
He puts on his magic
like,
items.
I mean, and he yep. What I love is how every item has a name.
It's got a name.
It's very specific, and it looks very D&D.
It's very D&D. It's things like, I'm going to arm myself with the spell, the excellent prismatic spray.
Yeah.
The sphere of omnipotence. Mm-hmm. The spell of the slow hour. Like the flowery language of all, you know, Fandol's first a charm or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
All of these things come from Vance. The flowery language, the picaresque adventures, just the weirdness, the mixing of technology and magic. So much is in Vance, and yet fancy and magic is largely, a lot of people don't like, deride it. And its expression now, by the time we get to 5th edition, is very different.
Yeah.
Than the novels, in which powerful magic users have 5 to 6 spells. But they're also like, this thing works. When this thing goes off, it changes things.
And it's permanent.
Yeah, it's permanent.
You're not going to concentrate on it.
Half a round of something out of it, and then it goes away. It's, you know, when they unleash the prismatic spray, it shreds the landscape.
Mm-hmm.
It's a style of magic that I find inspirational. I wouldn't call D&D style magic Vancian, personally. Neo-Vancian, pseudo-Vancian, doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, Jack Vance.
I think Neovancian is...
First off, Neovancian sounds like somebody's name.
I was going to say, it sounds like an awesome PC. I'm Neovancian. Tolkien gets a lot of credit for D&D.
He does, yeah.
As far as influence and everything.
Yeah.
But how would you balance like Tolkien's influence versus like, say, pulp?
I mean, Tolkien's influence should not be undervalued. Chainmail, which precedes Dungeons & Dragons, had reference to Middle-earth, and there's even some... evidence to suggest that like the chainmail was partially inspired by an earlier fan-made war game about how to play out battles in Middle-earth, right? Like The Hobbit, Lord of the Rings, big battles, natural fit with wargaming. First edition, first printing of Dungeons & Dragons has references to hobbits and ents and balrogs and got slammed by the Tolkien estate. And you can tell what printing of those early books you have by whether it has the mentions of Middle-earth stuff or it doesn't. And there's all other kinds of mentions of what we would call licensed properties. Now there's, you know, Edgar Rice Burroughs, Barsoom, John Carter, like as mentioned, Conan. It's one of those that it might look conspicuously absent. There's no Tolkien. And when you look at Appendix N, Tolkien's one of many authors on there. You know, it's not like he's placed at the top. And even when Gygax is like, oh, these few are like the most influential, Tolkien's not mentioned. Mm-hmm. But it turns out that we find out years and years later, part of that is because of that lawsuit. Mm-hmm. And that they were so scared of getting hit with another lawsuit from Tolkien that they downplayed the influence of Tolkien on D&D. I think it's there, but it's certainly not the most prevalent. In fact, I think someone like Paul Anderson has a lot more influence on D&D than Tolkien. When you read, like, say, Three Hearts, Three Lions, you know, you get the paladin, trolls, all kinds of fairy creatures. You get wizards and dwarves. Like, the story of Three Hearts, Three Lions is a World War II resistance fighter finds himself in fantasy France, torn between the forces of law and chaos, which are fighting a cosmic-scale conflict. Chaos represented by the elves of fairy, and law represented by the forces of man. But he shows up in the forest without any gear, and lo and behold, there's a magic horse with armor, weapons, barding, all the like that fit him perfectly. He knows how to use them. It's a paladin. Like, you're reading this, like, this is a story of a paladin. The fight with the troll, where they hack it to pieces and then its arm starts crawling across the floor and reattaching itself. They turn their back and go to leave, and then it stands up from where it was, re-knit together, is one of the most evocative pieces of fiction I've read. It's an action scene that's superb, it's creepy, it's weird, and it captures what in the world you're supposed to do with a troll. Like, what does the archetypal encounter with a troll look like? And then they have to burn it. They don't just, like, poke it with a torch. They set it on fire.
Yeah.
It's creepy. It's weird having to fight an opponent that just keeps getting back up no matter what limb you take off of it, no matter what organ you remove. It's going to keep going. The way that elves have an inherent magic that they use, to me, is a bigger influence and is more in line with D&D-style elves than Tolkien elves. Mm-hmm. Because when I look at D&D-style elves and Tolkien elves, they are not the same creature at all.
Yeah, Tolkien elves are more like ephemeral and just disassociated from the world.
Yeah, they're just, you know, they're ethereal and kind of celestial in a way that I don't think D&D translates very well, and removed from the world would be one of those, because, you know, it's possible for them to die of sadness. And of course, authors like Michael Moorcock would come along and develop the law versus chaos angle further. If you want to, like, point to the kind of D&D I love outside of the weird science fantasy stuff, it's Fritz Lieber. Mm-hmm. Tales of Lankmar, Swords of Devilry, Swords of Wizardry, Stories of Fofford and the Grey Mouser. This is as close to, like, D&D fiction as you get. Fofford is a barbarian from the north, raised by ice witches, society he had to flee for some taboo that he committed. So he's like a very kind of Conan-esque character, but a bit different, not as grim. And then the Grey Mouser is this thief who's a failed wizard. He couldn't hack it and cut it as a wizard, and so became a fencer and a thief. If Kuggle's partly an inspiration for the thief, then, like, Grey Mouser is the other inspiration. And if you've ever wondered why throughout D&D why thieves can sometimes use magic scrolls or some magic items, or why, like, use magic devices on their list in third edition, it's because of the Grey Mouser. It's because he knows a little bit of magic. you know, you can just do a little bit.
Yeah, he took a semester.
Right.
before he got bounced out.
Yeah. The first one I read, and I think this might be the first short story of him, it's like they get some girlfriends and they score big on a heist, but because they didn't give a cut to the Thieves Guild strikes back, and then they have to strike back after that. And then it's back and forth and back and forth. And that's it. And then the next one, it starts with, like, they got to get some more money. And, you mm-hmm. know, what do they do with their money when they get it? They spend it partying and boozing it up. And they live in this grotty, dirty, grubby city of Lankmar, which is also the greatest city in the world. And the bazaar of the bazaar is there. And they each have their own, what we would probably think of as a great old one warlock, as their patron. Well, who's my patron? I don't know. It's sort of a shabby-looking humanoid shape with a hood that has, like, seven eyes staring out of it at you. Sounds good. I'll take the job.
Yeah. You know?
They deal with epic themes and high magic and all this stuff while also being, like, really well-grounded. They inform a lot of, like, just the sense of adventure and action that mm-hmm. I like to bring to D&D.
Mm-hmm. How much pulp do you think should be in the game? Or how much do you have in your games, right?
I mean, I take a lot of inspiration from Sword and Sorcery because I find it evocative fiction. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I recognize that for a lot of people it's dated, problematic subject matter, and it's not the kind of fantasy they like. And what I would take from this, from the show, from whatever, is not that you have to read these books. You don't. You can enjoy D&D. You can play a great game of D&D without ever reading any of these or even being aware of them. I think they help you understand kind of the literary roots of D&D, how the game has developed over time. And to me, those are important for understanding both the current iteration of D&D and how I will relate to future versions of D&D.
Right, right.
So I like to include enough, you know, of the pulp elements in my games to facilitate that same sense of action and adventure. So, like, I don't require that players, like, play their character like it's a persona, like they're actors inhabiting another role. It's perfectly fine for me if a player just goes, like, yeah, this is my game piece. my character is my avatar for this world, and I will vicariously experience it through that. I like that. I play characters like that largely. Mm-hmm. I like the sense of just, you gotta go out there and scrape by. You know, the idea found in, like, Lieber, that your characters are low level, they're at the bottom of the social ladder, they've got to go break the law, break into old tombs, do all these things that normal people don't do, because yeah. they have normal jobs and things, but you're kind of weird, kind of quirky, don't fit in. You gotta have to break into a tomb and steal some cursed gold.
Yeah.
You know?
hopefully you can spend it before the curse catches up to you.
Right. Yeah, like, it's that kind of thing that I really enjoy about mm-hmm. Pulp fiction and the sword and sorcery subgenre that a lot of these are writing in. It helps me stay engaged. It helps me stay excited about the game. Mm-hmm. But, like, if I'm running for a bunch of people where they don't care about that, or they're just not steeped in that kind of thing, or the kind of game that I would run as a consequence of that, then I'm going to change it up and be like, oh, you know what? Today we're doing something different. It's going to be more like a big damn quest, mm-hmm. you know, or this one's going to be about, you know, political intrigue and high stakes, you know, kind of stuff. And to me, it's more about soaking yourself in literature mm-hmm. because, or in media, I guess, in this case. One of the things that I took away from reading Appendix N is this line that Gygax has, in which he's presenting this list for you, that says, like, I want you to be able to pluck kernels from which will grow the fruits of an exciting campaign.
Yeah.
You read these things so that you can take elements, not that you can recreate it whole cloth, but that you can go, that scene in that book, I love mm-hmm. that. I want to extrapolate that, turn it into a game element.
Yeah.
This place from this short story, mm-hmm. I've got to include in my game.
Yeah, that villain's ambition.
Yeah.
Is perfect for my villain.
It's perfect for my villain. So Appendix N represents what was in the popular mindset of geeks and wargamers and whoever at that time.
Yeah.
And it's still good, but it's not the end of the line. And so, like, the point is, steep yourself in what inspires you.
Yeah.
And have that inform how you run the game and share it with your players mm-hmm. so that you can all share in the same inspiration.
But never always be aware of the pitfalls that you mentioned earlier, because, I mean, as we've seen in Pulp, you know, sometimes you get ND4.
That's very true.
Sorry.
That's very true.
If you like the video, please like, subscribe, and go ahead and ring that bell to get those notifications.
The WebDM exists thanks to our Patreon patrons, the Web Demons.
If you join the Web Demons, you'll get our weekly podcast, show audio, discounts that'll save you way more than $5 a month on books and dice, and so much more. Check out our free podcast episodes right now, including our free interview with Luke Gygax about all things D&D.
If you like our advice for your games, then why don't you come check us out and watch us play?
Yeah, head on over to our second YouTube channel, WebDM Plays, and subscribe.
Thanks for watching.
What are we talking about, Jim?
We're talking about the literary influences of Dungeons & Dragons, specifically pulp fiction. The pulps.
But that movie came out after D&D.
It's true, the movie did.